Hooglied, vers vir vers, Hooglied 2 vers 9. Nog meer skatte asseblief en 'n eaglesview. Hooglied 2 vers 9. My beminde lyk soos 'n gemsbok of soos 'n takbok. Daar staan hy agter ons muur. Hy kyk deur die vensters in. Hy speur deur die tralies heen. Dit is nog steeds die bruid wat hierso praat met die medegelowiges.
Kan ek jou Superman, Batman, Iron Man, Spider-Man wees? Ek sal jou oppas in die donker, vir jou een hero wees. Kan ek jou Superman, Batman, Iron Man, Spider-Man wees? Ek sal die wereld vir jou aanvat, vir jou een hero wees.
Gemsbok, of soos een jong takbok. Daar is drie keer wat die bruid haar bruidegom vergelyk met 'n gemsbok of 'n takbok in Hooglied. Hy is energiek en passievol om by haar te wees. Geen hindernis sal keer dat hy by haar is nie. Dit is ook literatuur vir 'n mighty warriors of 'n virile young man. Ons kan ook op hierdie punt bid. Laat ons Jesus sien as die mighty warrior. Ek glo se baie mense steek vas by die punt van Jesus se lewe dat hy hierdie magtelose babietjie was. Dat ons nooit werklik groot word en Jesus begin sien as die mighty warrior nie. So bid elke dag dat jy net meer en meer van Jesus se krag sal sien in jou lewe. Dat jy sal sien hy is jou mighty warrior. Dat hy is jou Superman.
Step closer to knowing. One step closer to knowing. Closer to knowing. One step closer to knowing. One step closer to knowing. Knowing. Knowing.
Daar staan hy agter ons muur. Hy kyk deur die vensters in. In die vorige vers kom hy. Nou staan hy by haar huis. So God is 'n God van vordering. So op hierdie punt kan jy bid. Wys my Here, wys my elke dag hoe U vorder in my lewe. Hoe U little by little dinge verander in my lewe. Net soos met die Israeliete was hulle vordering little by little. En Paulus skryf ook ons groei van krag tot krag. So weer eens, Hooglied is 'n sinnebeeld van ons geloofsreis. In die film Beauty and the Beast wys die man net vir haar die verbode terrein en later in die film wys hy vir haar al die skatte van die paleis waarin sy bly. Net so begin ons ook as gelowiges met die moed en die moenies, die 10 gebooie. Maar as ons sal persevereer, as ons sal aanhou soek, sal ons ook die skatte begin ontdek wat God vir ons voorberei het. Hy kyk deur die tralies. Nou in hierdie wêreld sal ons net glimpse skryf van Jesus, maar in die ander wêreld sal ons die heerlikheid, sy volle heerlikheid sien. Paulus skryf ook hiervan dat ons net deur 'n donker spieël kyk, maar ons sal verander en 'n beter prentjie sien. Maar op hierdie punt mag ons ook bid, laat ons die groter prentjie sien. Dis op daardie oomblik wanneer ons begin verstaan wat was God se groter doel agter die trauma, waar die groei en die vernuwing plaasvind. 3 jaar terug was ek in 'n verkeerde verhouding. Ons het 'n oomblik gehad, 'n baie spesiale oomblik gehad by 'n spesifieke plek in Johannesburg. Ek was altyd hartseer na die tyd wanneer ek teruggedink het aan hierdie oomblik. 'n jaar later nooi 'n man my uit om saam met hom in sy helikopter te gaan vlieg. Hy was onbewus van die plek en die verhaal van my ex-kerel. Maar terwyl ek oor die plek vlieg, besef ek God het dit so voorbeskik dat ek 'n eagle's view het van die plek.
You can stand at the edge of a forest, staring at one tree, missing the beauty of the whole while so close to only the one part. You stare at the trunk, face up close, eyes locked onto what you think is the only sight to see, but if you step back, oh what a beautiful world it would be. Or maybe you're at a lake or the sea, and you are sitting on the beach, but you're turned, facing away. Head down to the sand or to the dirt, missing the waves in the water, missing the view. I'm not saying the tree isn't beautiful or the sand isn't worthy of admiration. What I'm saying is, you let those things block you from the truth that is the forest, the truth that is the lake, the truth that is the whole. You're so zoomed in on the tree or the grains of sand or grassy land that you forget about everything else. You lose perspective. Let's take this into non-analogous terms and talk the real-life realm. An example. Let's say you attempt something and it fails. You fail. Now, you can see it as a failure, get down on yourself, say, oh, I couldn't do it. Or instead of seeing that failure as only failure, you can build off of it and see it as an opportunity to grow, to learn from it, to do better next time, that failure maybe wasn't a failure at all. You change your perspective on the situation. You zoom out. It's all about your outlook. Well, let's say you're mad at people in your life and you get so caught up thinking, oh, my sister is so mean. But then you think to see the situation differently and you realize she didn't intentionally hurt your feelings. It was a misunderstanding. But if you didn't zoom out and only stayed stuck in your original line of thinking, your conclusion would have been much different. See, our perception is often blocked because we get so caught up in our own dealings, own feelings. We forget to reason. We forget to look at how a situation is different, like the seasons. This concept need not apply to only one thing. Zooming out sometimes in all aspects of your life is a good thing. We seem to live in a world where people don't want to look at things from someone else's point of view. They don't do it. But stepping into someone else's shoes, so to speak, is one of the most powerful things that can help you move towards a place of compassion and love for others. You don't necessarily have to agree with where someone is coming from, but just to see it is a powerful thing, because it brings you into a place of understanding that you didn't have before. And when we understand people's reasons, situations, and circumstances more, it's easier to see why someone does what they do. Everyone seems to want to view the world in their own way, without acknowledgement, recognition, or attempts to see it, maybe a bit differently. I urge you, find your perspective, find a better outlook, zoom out, and find the bigger picture.